I didn't plan on making a video about Rain World Hard Mode. I mean, playing through the same game again, but with stronger enemies and larger health bars isn't going to be that different, aside from an increased death count, and that hardly deserves the time it takes to make one of these, or even just the time it takes to play. In Rain World, though, there aren't so much different difficulties as there are different games entirely, and you can see this right off the bat when selecting the Hard Mode character, the Hunter. First of all, I'm red now. Also, haven't seen this before. This entire area, known as the Farm Arrays, is entirely optional in normal mode, but is your starting point as the Hunter. And no, I had never been here before. Or the next area. Or the two areas after that. Yeah, don't worry about things being repetitive if you've already watched my other Rain World video. We've got all new regions, all new enemies, and plenty of all new ways to die, of which I will be revealing to you as many as I can. So, you know, spoilers. Hope you enjoy. So as much as I would love to stay and hang around with this guy, who I love and will protect at all costs, we leave the Farm Arrays pretty quickly. Don't worry, we will be coming back later for unfortunate reasons, but for now, our goal is to... Actually, I'm not sure yet. I'm assuming the objective is the same as the survivors, reach 5 pebbles to max out your trust, and then head down to the end in the subterranean to complete the game, but I have no idea where I even am, with even the next zone I reach, the Sky Islands, being completely unfamiliar to me as well. With so many brand new environments being thrown my way, I honestly assumed I was on a completely different map to the base game. I don't know if this was an intentional decision by the developers to make sure you didn't miss out on anything, or just pure coincidence, but I greatly appreciated it nonetheless. Something I didn't appreciate, though, was hunger. The first obvious change from the base game I noticed, aside from the spawn point, was that the hunger bar was larger now. With the number of flies around, I didn't think it'd be a problem, but... Yep, I'd need to eat 24 of these to even have enough to hibernate, and by the time I'd caught that many, the ever-present time limit in the form of a not-so-light shower would be upon me. Every now and then, you'll come across a popcorn plant that'll give you as much food as you want, or find one of these guys who function as walking pantries, but whenever you're not that lucky, you have one other choice. Yep, lizards have gone from a dangerous threat to a food source. A food source that will still totally kill you, but in order to not starve, it's high time I learned to fight back. Turns out lizards are far from the unkillable monsters I thought they were in the base game, taking only 2 to 3 hits with a spear to bring down. Their heads are armored, though, meaning once they've started looking at you, you might be in a bit of trouble, but they're much more manageable than I thought they were. Oh, also they can fly now. Yeah, this is absolute nonsense. I don't care if they only take 2 hits to kill. I can't throw spears vertically. Well, okay, I can, but only straight down, and I'll get to how later. But if one of these things is barreling towards me at 200 miles an hour from straight overhead, there's not much I'll be doing about it. These guys are difficult to fight, near impossible to run from, and resulted in only a fraction of my deaths because everything is horrible now, and I'm not just talking about the enemies. Rain World has this neat little mechanic called reputation. It's kind of complicated, and I'm not going to pretend like I understand the whole system, but basically, doing good things for a species means they'll like you, and doing bad things like murder will make them murder you back. This can be seen on an individual level, where feeding and hibernating with a lizard can make them friendly, or on a species-wide level, like how I ate a few of these flying squid guys and now everyone I see is trying to knock me into a pit. It's one of the most interesting and rewarding aspects of the game to interact with, and almost acts as a difficulty option, as the more things you kill, the more things are out to kill you. Or, you know, you could just select the Hunter, whose reputation is instantly set to -35 just for existing, and nothing shows this more than the scavengers. Now, don't get me wrong, I wasn't exactly on the friendliest terms with those guys in my survivor run, but here they take it to a whole new level. I could hardly even leave the shelter without being chased down and impaled by roaming groups of these guys. They get in my way when I'm dealing with vultures, pop out of pipes right before I enter them, and even throw these little web traps so I can't escape. They're horrible, they hate me, and I hate them back. But they are still not the most dangerous enemy here. At this point, you might be getting confident in your ability to fight back against everything the game's throwing at you. You can hold your own against vultures, you can beat up the lizards, to hell, you could eat the lizards, but there's one more enemy that you'll have to learn to deal with. Coming from the sky to ruin my morning, afternoon, and rest of the week, we have the gun vultures. Now, I could forgive boost lizards, I guess it's kind of like how squids rocket around at 20 miles an hour by shooting water out of their heads, but I refuse to believe nature naturally evolved laser sights for its hookshot shooting sky beasts. I'm sure the lore probably has an explanation, but my understanding of said lore is, loose at best, so for now I'll just keep complaining about the vulture with a gun. This thing is an absolute nightmare, flying in at any and every time to kill you and any unfortunate creature that happens to be nearby. It's consistently terrifying to be wandering around, thinking you're safe, then catching a glimpse of that thin red line and knowing you have seconds to sprint for shelter or you are getting sent back to a checkpoint. I'd never killed one of these things, fighting back against them was only ever a mistake, and while I've heard wearing their mask lets you scare enemies off, I never even got close to getting the opportunity. Returning to the parts of the game that aren't full of spears, teeth, and death, the third area, the chimney canopy, has something weird going on. Accompanying the godlike music in the area, we have a godlike being. This thing, called an echo, is a remnant of a past human, I think, that learned how to escape the cycle of life and death. I think. But what I do know is that it gives us some trust, meaning we've finally made some actual progress. With the echo gone, though, the area gets refilled with enemies, which means even more gun vultures, which means even more death. Oh, and scavengers. There are still a bunch of these guys running around and making things very hard for me, but not everything is bad news. A while ago, I learned that eating these little guys attracts their very angry moms, so I avoided them. Now, I figured out that a well-placed spear will allow us to eat the mom too, giving plenty of food to hibernate. I ended up with so much spare that I didn't even need to leave the shelter to fall back asleep. This was a mistake. Never do this. Please do not do this. I'll explain why later. So after making our way through the vulture-infested canopy, we're onto the final new area, the wall. This area is almost purely vertical and filled top to bottom with lizards. There's one checkpoint at the start and one at the end, so you've got to make the entire climb in a single run. If you hadn't figured it out yet from the last few minutes, surviving is not my strong suit, so I spent way too long in this zone. Like, 23 entire attempts long. There was one lizard, I could probably handle it, but the moment more than one showed up, I crumbled. The verticality of the area makes it super hard to escape them, especially the boost lizards who feel like they never give up once they've seen you. Add that on to the gun vultures who loved showing up at the worst possible times, and these little ceiling beetle guides who ambush you when you're least expecting it, and you can probably start to see where my issues come from. Even when I did finally get past all the enemies, I failed to notice the fake poles and had to do it all over again. And again. And again, but the worst part came when I finally cleared it. You see, there's one aspect of hard mode that I haven't mentioned yet, and that's because I had no idea that existed until this moment you're watching right now. The hunter is slowly dying, and they only have 19 cycles to get everything done before the entire save file wipes itself. This hurts. Especially after taking so long to get past the wall, being told I had to do it all over again felt plain unfair, especially since I'd been playing without even thinking I was on a time limit. I'd wasted cycles without even leaving the shelter just because I thought it was funny. I thought I was just wasting food, not time. The game does give you a cycle count that ticks down every time you sleep, so if you're paying attention, you can assume this is happening, but I'm, blind, so I was completely blindsided when the results screen showed up and started rating my performance. Also, it somehow managed to crash in the middle of the count, so I was left with a beautiful score of negative 45. I was very annoyed, to say the least, but with no other option, I started up another run. My second attempt was leagues better than the first. My knowledge of the time limit combined with my exploration from the last run to get me all the way back to the wall in a mere 3 cycles, with only one death to a gun vulture along the way. The most important contributor to this speed was my willingness to skip checkpoints. By intentionally not resting in every shelter I came across, I kept the remaining cycle count high, but it did bring a new issue to my attention. Karma gates. Before, these had just seemed like an annoyance, just a simple test to see if I could survive for a few cycles in an area before letting me onto the next, but now that my cycle count was limited, these things were terrifying. With every death, my karma decreased, and that was one more cycle I had to spend resting to bring it back up and make it through the gate. This made my repeated deaths on my second trip back up the wall feel even worse. Almost instantly reaching the lowest karma possible, I started wondering if whatever was waiting for me at the end of this area was even worth it. Fortunately, though, I wasn't alone this time. I'd brought a friend from an earlier zone who made the climb significantly easier. Now, it wasn't a piece of cake, I died 8 more times, but having increased jump height in a mostly vertical area was super helpful. It did mean, however, that I couldn't pull out my spear to kill any lizards without letting him go, so when I got to the top, I didn't have the food I needed to save my progress. I had one source of food. So, what's at the top of this wall I'd been trying so hard to climb? Well, there's an echo who increases our karma cap again, which is great, but the other paths are too high up for us to reach. Or at least they would be if you guys hadn't told me about a helpful little piece of tech in the comments in the last video. Doing a backflip lets you throw spears directly into the ground, providing a miniature pole to climb on, which lets you reach higher up areas that would be inaccessible otherwise. It took a few attempts to get right, but after a little practice, I achieved some consistency. Using this method requires a second spear to get all the way up, unless you want to do whatever this is, but I couldn't even tell you how that works, so after throwing the second spear into the wall, I made my way up through the pipe and found 5 pebbles. When playing as the default survivor, he instantly gives you max karma, but while the hunter's cap only increases by 1, he gives you something even more helpful. More cycles. Well, I say more helpful, but that does mean we still need to seek out 2 more echoes before we can pass by the guardians at the end of the game, but having extra cycles will definitely help with that. Less helpful is how 5 pebbles sent us back the way we came, meaning to continue, I need to make my way through the wall again, this time going backwards. Somehow, this felt even harder than the initial climb up, and by the time I was done, my karma was practically empty again, even though it had just been filled up completely. This wouldn't be too terrible, as all the karma gates in the area have relatively low requirements, but the echoes, including the one from the first run that I tried to return to, only show up when you're close to full, only making this blue flash if you don't have enough. Between getting back to the chimney canopy and building my karma back up, I had already used up all the extra cycles I had been given. With only 12 remaining, I tried to be as careful as possible with the karma the Echo had given me, but it felt impossible. A weird vulture that was missing its face kept showing up and killing me, the ceiling beetles were everywhere, even right outside my spawn, and you'd better bet the scavengers were still coming after me as relentlessly as ever. By the time I'd found the final Echo and made my way back to the farm arrays, my remaining cycle count was in the single digits, and I just had to hope I could get to the subterranean karma gate on the opposite side of the area without dying so much that I couldn't meet the gate requirement without wasting even more cycles. Unfortunately, this area was a bit of a nightmare. Yep, the scavengers are back again, and this time they've set up an entire toll road I have to pay my way through. Fighting is definitely not an option here, so I gave away the special pearl I'd been saving for the entire game in exchange for passage, and made my way onto an obstacle that's physically impossible for me to cross on my own. Good thing I'm not alone though, this deer thing from the very start is back, and he is my best friend, and I love him. He loves the little smoke bomb things in the area, so if I give him one, he'll let me ride on his antlers across the dangerous grabby murder grass. The way he moves with his, I think, four legs, completely unaffected by the grass, it's just... Well, it's a good reminder of why I'm playing this game. We're like, what, 10 minutes into this video, and I know a lot of it comes off kind of complainy. Ooh, this is too hard, this is impossible, a scavenger killed me for the 500th time, and I know for people who are fans of the game that's probably getting a little annoying. I just want to make it clear that I do really enjoy this game. Going across these fields with my horse thing, it's just... I don't even know how to describe it. The audio for this bit probably sounds different from the rest of the video, and that's because I had to re-record it like four times just trying to explain what it is that I enjoy so much, and I still can't put it into exact words. I mean, I made an entire second video on the game. I hope that's enough proof that I'm having fun. I'm probably gonna make a few more after this, honestly. I'm having a great time, but unfortunately, the journey had to come to an end, and I had to leave my friend behind. I only hope I'll meet him again one day. I have no clue what that sound was, and I choose not to learn. I will live in blissful ignorance. Now down to 8 cycles remaining, I had to make my way through the rest of the farm arrays alone. Well, not alone, we still have plenty of enemies to deal with, including these new guys who also have guns, because apparently that's just what hard mode in this game means. These ones aren't an insta-kill, just paralyzing you for a few seconds instead, but not being able to move makes escaping from predators pretty hard. Fortunately, some more careful and patient gameplay later, I'd made my way past them and to the final karma gate. Having made my way onto the final zone, I figured I was pretty much done. After all, it didn't matter how many times I died, since my karma didn't matter without any more gates to go through. I may have had only 6 cycles left, but I was confident I could get through the subterranean without needing that many checkpoints. What I didn't count on was being unable to make my way through the subterranean at all. I was instantly welcomed by more of the paralyzing gun spiders with a follow-up visit from more large centipedes, but neither of those were what really caused me trouble. No, the biggest obstacle was this even larger centipede I am now dubbing King Centipede. Because there is no centipede stronger than him. He is fast, he is dangerous, he's immune to spears, and he's big. I didn't even have to fight him, I just had to get past this one area where he lives with like 5,000 of his centipede subjects, but it felt, again, impossible. He was just too fast, and even when I did manage to get past the centipedes, more gun spiders or even boost lizards would show up and kill me instead. The few times I got past the full room, though, I died to something else. Like this guy. Don't see him? Too bad, guess you're dead. This game is very fair and balanced. But finally, finally, I made my way past because the King Centipede just wasn't there, and after a quick nap with a friendly lizard, I made it to the end. Well, there were a few more obstacles, like this nonsense, but I'd made my way through this area without any light before, so this wasn't anything compared to the 100-legged nightmare I'd just endured. The ending itself was much the same, with the only difference being the ending images it shows you. Spoilers, 3, 2, 1, your sickness gets removed, I think, and then you just kind of relax in the arms of this robot person who I don't know. It's nice, but it did remind me of something important. I'm not done yet, there's one more thing I need to do. Back when we met 5 Pebbles, he mentioned that Looks to the Moon wasn't doing too well. According to the lore, it's because 5 Pebbles is stealing the water she needs to live, but it might also have something to do with my actions back during the Survivor run. Maybe. Okay, probably, but we spawn in with one of her neuron brain jellyfish at the start of the Hunter run that makes funny glowing shapes for us, so before I consider this done, I have to make up for my past actions. Yes, this is a public apology, please don't get mad at me in the comments again, I didn't know what I was doing. The third run didn't take long at this point. I knew where I was going, I knew how to fight, I could even take out vultures, not you, which gave me a neat little mask to wear. I instantly lost it to a bunch of scavengers because of course I did, but it's an achievement I'm proud of nonetheless. I made my way back down the path I was supposed to take the first time through, learning neat things like how some shelters are just broken when you play as the hunter and how the Leviathan things are definitely very hostile. Before long though, I'd made it to Lux to the Moon, who is doing a little worse than Not Well had suggested. Giving her the neuron revived her though, meaning I have officially atoned for my sins and you are no longer legally allowed to get mad at me, okay? Okay. Then she refused to read the pearl I gave her, so I stole her neurons anyways. That's it. Bye.